So we have, you know, we've had a number of sessions in which we've talked about site selection, the question of what kinds of science was expected in the Apollo program, what the role of the crew had been in terms of contributions, and you heard from several of our speakers how crew training contributed to the participation. And one of the remarkable things was in a way how elementary some of the questions were that were being asked at that time, and how much more we now know about the moon. And the person that I know who knows most about it is Professor Zuber. Maria Zuber is the recipient of all the highest awards that this country gives out. She is has been the principal investigator on a number of planetary missions, and most recently just completed, not the analysis, but completed the data gathering portion of the GRAIL mission, which I'm sure she will tell us about today. Maria is formerly head of the Department of Earth and Planetary Sciences, is currently also the Vice President for Research at MIT, and we're delighted that you could get here.
Thank you. All right, so. All right, so just a little bit of background. MIT has a long history of lunar exploration, of which I'm humbled to be a small part of. Picture of Doc Draper here with Wernher von Braun, the Apollo guidance computer. If it weren't for this, we wouldn't have gotten to the moon. 2,000 words of RAM, and it was just an amazing, amazing thing. But it worked, and of course, all of you are familiar with Buzz Aldrin, who was the.
We have a visit scheduled to the museum, and they'll be able to see many of these artifacts.
Actually, see these artifacts. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's just it's amazing stuff, and so, all right. So this is the near side of the moon that we see from Earth. The far side of the moon that we don't see from Earth, and you can see that the near side looks different than the far side. Okay, the near side has these large impact basins that have been flooded with volcanic material, much less so volcanic material on the far side. And it used to be thought that what happened is that the topography of the far side highlands, as the term goes, is high, and therefore this magma that came up from deep inside the moon never made it to the surface. Okay. However, down here, this is a 1,700 kilometer diameter impact basin that's deeper than any basin on the near side, but it has virtually no volcanic material to speak of in it. It's only slightly darker because as you go deeper in the crust, the minerals have a slightly higher iron and magnesium content, so they look a little bit darker to the eye. These highland materials here are silica and aluminum rich, and so are very, very bright. Okay, so at the time when we were considering what to do next, the United States plus the other nations of Earth had sent over 100 missions towards the moon. Okay, not all of them got there. Some of them missed, some of them crashed, some of them landed and returned samples, some of them orbited, some of them put people on the moon who brought back samples. But 100 missions to the moon later, we don't know why the near side of the moon is different than the far side of the moon. Okay, so I never do anything complicated. Okay, and it's not rocket science to say that if you've sent 100 missions to the moon and you haven't figured something out, then the answer isn't where you're looking. Okay, and so it occurred to us that. Maybe we should look beneath the surface to see what's going on, okay? And that was really the motivation for wanting to do the GRAIL mission, which was to do a very global high-resolution gravity map, okay? The other The other thing that is a key issue in planetary evolution is the impact cratering record. Okay, so all these big areas with the dark spots, those are all big impact basins, but these are all impacts as well. And most of the action here occurred just after the formation of the planets. Okay, so as the planets accreted, all the junk that was left over would impact the surfaces of the planets. Of course, there's the kinetic energy of heating associated with the impacts here, and of course that is the major process that shaped the earliest surfaces of the terrestrial planetary bodies. And the moon is nearby, and it preserves an ancient surface, so it's very well preserved there. So what was going on back on Earth at the time when all these impacts are occurring? Well, the same thing. Okay, so Earth is actually a bigger gravitational target, so it's going to get hit with more stuff even than the moon is. And this is just a little clock-like diagram of Earth history here, where the first humans come in right before midnight at 2 million years ago, and the dinosaurs die off right here, and then you go all the way back, and so where is the bombardment? Okay, well, it's right here. Okay, this is where where most of those impact craters occurred, the period of time when most of those impact craters occurred. So this is what we call the end of the late heavy bombardment. And this happens to be the same time, more or less, that the first prokaryotes were forming on the Earth. So by studying the early impact history, we can get some understanding of what the early treacherous, horrible surface conditions were on the surface of the planets at the time that life was emerging. Okay, and you know, goodness knows how many times life got started and got wiped out by these giant impacts. So this is this just gives you some, if you want to do a mission, in the NASA planetary or astrophysics, heliophysics, whatever, you have to have a good reason for doing it. You could have really good technology, but unless you have a very compelling reason to do it, you'll never get out of the starting blocks on it. So, the early history of the solar system and relationship to the, earliest conditions of life on Earth, it worked. Okay, it was a good motivation. So the objective of GRAIL was just not to map the lunar gravity field, although that's what we did. It was to determine the structure of the lunar interior from the crust to the core, and to use this to understand the evolution of the moon, and from what we learned to the moon, really extend the knowledge that we gained there to understand other rocky planets. Okay. But then you need to design a system that's going to do that. So that's kind of the big picture, standing on the top of the mountain and looking out, and so that we can then dissect that to lower levels and come up with individual scientific objectives. So these four all had to do with measuring the gravity in high resolution areas on the surface, so that we could make a nice map that we could then interpret in terms of internal structure. And then these objectives dealt with the deep interior of the moon, things that you don't see on a map. This gets to the very longest wavelength gravitational shape, and these deal with doing very, very precise measurements of the longest wavelength terms of the gravity field. So this is my first public presentation where I can tell you that we have achieved full mission success. Okay, for GRAIL, I sent. Yeah, the it's a, okay, so. So I sent the memo to NASA last night saying that we achieved all of these objectives. And that's why I'm late, because we were having a little party in my research group over to celebrate this. So these objectives, we actually did those last May, and these this objective here, this is K2 is the tide, the solid tide of the moon. Okay, and so as the moon raises a tide on the Earth, so you can see the tides come in and out, and the Earth also raises a tide on the moon, but it's a solid tide. And as the spacecraft is in orbit, it gets perturbed by those tidal terms, and so we needed to measure that. And then this term here, this deals with the fact we think that the we now know that the interior of the moon has a solid inner core that's metal, a slightly fluid outer core, and then a solid mantle, and that the moon over the course of an 18.6 year precession cycle, the moon processes about the ecliptic plane of the sun, which is basically if the sun is wearing a belt, okay, it's extend that out, and the moon actually processes about that plane, and this this term of the gravity field here talks about the orientation of the moon's spin axis, and we've actually measured that precession of the moon's over the course of a couple of months to a part in 10th of the 10th, okay. So it's not the most trivial measurement in the world to make. So, but that said, it was easier than I thought. Okay. So the moon is the first planetary body that we measured gravity at, other than Earth. Okay. So the first spacecraft that went to the moon needed to map the moon's gravity field because we needed to know it well enough to send other spacecraft there to look for landing sites for the Apollo astronauts. These spacecraft got bounced around a lot because of large gravitational attractions that the spacecraft experienced when they went over these dark areas. And this is something called mass cons, which are mass concentrations. And so the idea was that these are filled with material that's more dense than this material here. And so the origin of mass cons, turns out to be, it's one of the biggest questions in planetary science. And it was one of the things that that motivated us. And in fact, we've now figured this out, and I won't be talking about it today because it's a little bit complicated, but it's in press and science, so you'll be seeing it soon enough. So measuring gravity on the moon well has been an objective for a long time, in part to understand the origin of mass cons, and in part to do other things. Despite the fact that the moon is nearby, we had a worse gravity field of the moon than we have for various other planets. So I would often get emails from people saying, can I have a gravity field of the moon, a nice gravity field of the moon, like your Mars gravity field? And of course, one didn't exist. And why not, okay? Well, that goes with how we usually measure gravity on a planet. So what we usually do is, you don't even need an instrument. In theory. So every spacecraft has a radio on it, and the radio has a known signal. And as the spacecraft is going around in its orbit, you just look at the frequency shift of the radio signal. And when the spacecraft's coming towards you, that signal gets blue shifted. When it's going away from you, it gets red shifted. And you track that on a tracking station on Earth. So you get the velocity then, because that's just Doppler shift, so velocity in the line of sight. Take the derivative of velocity, and that's acceleration. and acceleration is the units of gravity. And then all you have to do to get the gravity of the planet is subtract away all the accelerations that aren't due to gravity. And then what you're left with is gravity. So that could be thrusting maneuvers, de-spinning your gyros, drag in the atmosphere if you're in a planet that has an atmosphere, the pressure of photons from the sun, so solar radiation pressure is a big one, re-radiation, IR radiation from the planet onto the spacecraft. On Grail, actually, our biggest source of error is the thermal shock of going across the terminator from in light to, so all those things you correct for. And then, given that you have to measure things to a part in 10 to the 10th, you have to worry about error sources that are down at the part in 10 to the 10th level. So you have to make all the full general relativistic, do space-time corrections. You need to subtract away the gravitational attractions of all the planets in the solar system. You need to correct for the weather at the tracking station. And we even correct for the tectonic drifts of the plates at the tracking station. So, but it's an easy measurement in principle. Okay, so we do all that. Okay, so you do that. But on the moon, you never see you can never track directly from on the far side. And so the way that you get around that, so you can never make a good far side gravity map. So even when you're tracking on the near side, you're actually sensitive to gravity on the far side. But so you get the long wavelengths out, kind of, but the short wavelengths are really mucked up, and I'll show you a map of that. But the way that you get around that is that you send two spacecraft, and then you just let them track each other. And then it doesn't matter if you're on the near side or the far side. Then you just contact Earth whenever you're in view of the Earth, and you can do all the timing and other stuff that you need to be. So anyway, here are the two spacecraft. Let's see, it's all radio signals. Okay, so there's a gravity processing unit that generates signals. We calculate the distance change. We essentially calculate the distance change between two spacecraft, which gives you velocity. We difference that to get acceleration, then you essentially have a proof mass that's in orbit around the moon, and you can get gravity out of that. So we do this at 32 gigahertz. So we have these antennas here that both transmit and receive. We're doing pseudo range. It's all relative ranges. It doesn't have to be known absolutely with respect to Earth. It just has to be known relative to each other. And so we use an S-band system at 2 gigahertz to correlate the time tags of the Ka band data. And then there actually is a mission, a satellite-to-satellite mission around Earth that's measuring gravity as we speak. It's called GRACE, and it's a... So timing is really important, and GRACE uses GPS to calibrate time, and there was no GPS at the moon. So the way that we get around that is we have a very accurate clock. We call it an ultra-stable oscillator. We pick off a signal from that clock. We generate an X-band tone, and then we send that to Earth, and it gets picked up and sent to the ground station at Earth, where we then calibrate it with a maser, a very, very accurate clock. And so we can get the timing down. So this is all the hardware. And for a mission, this was a dream come true, because normally gravity is an add-on to any mission. The spacecraft is slewing this way to take this image, or it's doing this to get a limb scan of atmosphere. And of course, when you want to measure gravity, you want to minimize any perturbation so that everything that you measure is actually associated with the gravity field of the planet. And so it was great just to be working on a mission where you were doing a dedicated measurement. So this is actually an interesting idea conceptually that you guys might want to think about when you're developing your missions is that many of these missions get developed and they put all these instruments on and they address all these objectives and say, well, we can do this killer thing if we just have a dozen instruments looking at all these different things that we're going to correlate with each other. And we took an opposite approach. We used a very, very focused measurement, but wrote extremely sweeping, broad objectives. So the early impact history of the solar system and the thermal evolution of the moon. And what we did is said, well, there's a treasure trove of other observations that already exist. And really, the missing piece of the puzzle is doing this observation extremely precisely. So it's a philosophical thing. And you can get things to work, any way that you want to. But this is the way that we went about that. So this is, many of you are engineers, so this is a nice picture in the thermal vacuum chamber here. And so this is just a little video of how the measurement works. So the two spacecraft are in the nominal mission 55 kilometers above the surface of the moon. They're ranging to each other. We vary the distance between 60 and 250 or so kilometers in the primary mission. They're in a polar orbit, so the moon rotates underneath them. And then as there's a mass at the surface or below the surface, the first spacecraft speeds up because it gets attracted by this mass and increases this distance. And then this spacecraft starts to feel the effect, and then it speeds up. So it's just like this accordion that goes on over the course of the moon. So it launched on September 10th, 2011. I'm going to talk about the took separate trajectories to the moon. I'm going to talk about the trajectories. Had to do a whole bunch of maneuvers. I'm going to say several things about mission design. It turned out to be extremely operationally intensive. We wound up doing, between the two spacecraft, 78 maneuvers over the course of the mission with no errors. Neither spacecraft ever entered safe mode, which is, we think, the first time that ever happened on a NASA mission, and this was two spacecraft. We met our baseline requirements a year early, all the requirements now, and we collected more than 99.99% of all the data we could have collected and got it to Earth. And then we purposely crashed the two spacecraft in the moon, and I'll talk about that. And we hit every developmental milestone, and we're giving NASA a lot of money back. So everything went well. Okay. All right. So I'm going to talk to you about the mission design and the implementation because this was dual spacecraft, single string, okay? And if you started this out and you said dual spacecraft, single string, the rational person would say high risk, you will never be selected, okay? Our philosophy was low risk implementation. Okay, so we decided we would do, we would take proactive steps to manage risk to a reasonable level. Okay, and one of these things was the trajectory to the moon. The Apollo astronauts went to the moon in 3 days and came back. We went to the moon in 3 months. So I said separate trajectories to go to the moon. We use the Lagrange point here, where gravity balances between the Earth-Moon system and the Sun. There were many reasons we did this. Okay, the The first reason is that it gave us huge flexibility in our launch date. Okay, we were able to just nudge the spacecraft in the direction of the Lagrange point, and then come around. And you know, if you go to the moon in 3 days, you're barreling towards the moon, and then you gotta hit the brakes to have the lunar gravity capture you, and you need a big fuel tank, all right? And we had two little spacecraft that were actually, the spacecraft design was a classified spacecraft that we got permission from the Air Force to declassify it and use it. And we didn't want to redesign it for a bigger fuel tank. And so we decided to use a trajectory that was low energy. And so we only, about 200 meters a second was all we had to slow down to get into lunar orbit. Okay, so we were able to use the same fuel tanks. So no redesign of the spacecraft system. Also, when we were on the way to the moon, we let the spacecraft degas, because degassing of the structure is an error source. Taking 3 months to go to the moon also allowed us, the engineers, to learn how to drive the spacecraft. And another thing was, when we sent them to the moon separately over the course of 3 months, we were able to time it so that the spacecraft would get into orbit 25 hours apart, so that we were not doing two mission critical maneuvers in 1 day, okay? And then it turns out that no matter what day in the launch window, and the launch window was practically 50 days long, no matter what day we launched in those 50 days, we would get to the moon the same days, New Year's Eve and New Year's Day, which means that you could completely decouple the cruise operations from the in-orbit operations. So all of these things that I've told you were great risk reduction activities. And because we didn't have to redesign the spacecraft and make them bigger, we were able to use one rocket rather than two. So we saved $100 million by doing that. So there were many good reasons to do that. Okay. Now this is a little bit of a complicated diagram, but let me explain it to you, because we were very dependent on the sun. Okay, so the primary mission lasted from March through the end of May of last year at a 55 kilometer mean altitude, and the extended mission lasted from September through December of last year, where we brought the altitude down by a factor of two and orbited the moon at an average altitude of 23 kilometers. So the spacecraft, again, simplicity, fixed solar panels, okay, a ranging system. So the two spacecraft had to point to each other in range, and they also had to have enough sunlight on them to power themselves. And our initial calculations indicated that they couldn't make it through eclipses, okay? That there would be an eclipse every 6 months. And so there was an eclipse in early December of 2011. And so we had to get there after that, and then there was another eclipse in June, so we had to get there after that. So here's our, so we launched, here's our cruise phase, there's our eclipse. So we got to the moon a little bit after that. We did a whole series of maneuvers. So we get into an elliptical orbit, and instead of doing one big maneuver to get a spacecraft into a low orbit, we did lots of little maneuvers, so that if you do one maneuver, it's mission critical. If you do lots of little maneuvers, no burn is mission critical. You could miss one and just do a little bit more in the subsequent ones. So it turns out they all went well. So this was our orbit period reduction phase, where we did a bunch of maneuvers. And then this was the transition to science phase, where we lined them up so that they would start ranging. And then here was the science phase. So then we went, there's another eclipse, and then no ranging in the summer. Okay, and here's why. Okay, so So the here's the solar panels. The solar panels are the palms of my hand. You people are the sun, okay? The two spacecraft are ranging to each other. So so we start here and we're ranging and we got sunlight, and then the end of May comes and we don't see the sun anymore. Okay, so we gotta break the link, okay, and that's what happens in the summer there. So in the summer they're just doing their thing. And then we bring them back together, but we then have to flip them, and then we could range again for another 6 months, okay? What often happens in extended missions is you need to propose some new science, but what people often say they like to do is, well, long-term monitoring. We want to do long-term monitoring. And we could have done that for the moon, but for reasons that I'll show you, we made the decision that we really wanted to go as low as possible, because no matter what the performance of your system is, if you want high resolution on the surface, you got to go low. And so, so I challenged my engineering team. I said, "How good are you guys?" Okay, and. So we decided we'd go down a factor of 2 over what we did in the mean mission. And then, so we did that, and then the last couple of weeks we went down, we took it down another factor of 2 and got down to an average of 11 kilometers. So so here's the primary mission, okay? This is altitude in kilometers, and this is time. So here's March, and here's the end of May. And this is the distance between the two spacecraft, okay? And so here is, so although we said the average altitude is 55 kilometers, realize that the moon has a very bumpy gravity field, and there's really no such thing as a circular orbit, okay? So when we started mapping, the apoapsis was 90, and the periapsis was, what is it, about 25 here, and then it evolved, and it got kind of circular, and then it evolved again, and so then we had to do a maneuver to bring it up, or it would have crashed. Because what happens is, an orbit will start circular, and then it'll get elliptical. So the apoapsis goes up, the periapsis goes down, and eventually the periapsis intersects the surface of the moon, and you crash. Okay. So, but the beauty of this mission design was, here's the drift rate between the two spacecraft. So we went for 3 months. Doing one maneuver for two spacecraft. And this was just, the spacecraft started drifting apart, and eventually they were going to get to the point where one was going to be over the horizon from the other, and they wouldn't see each other, and so they wouldn't be able to range. So we just did a little maneuver to start bringing them closer together. So this is beautiful for measuring gravity. And so then all these areas that are in blue here, this is just a map of the moon. This is all areas in the primary mission where we had data below 30 kilometers in altitude, okay? So, but it got better. Then in the primary mission, very different situation. In the extended mission, you start at 23 kilometers, the orbit immediately goes elliptical, and we were always within a week of crashing into the moon, okay? So we had to do 3 maneuvers a week to prevent crashing into the moon. So raise one up, raise the other one up, and then line them up. And then in this one, anywhere that's blue in this map, coverage map here, is at an altitude above the moon similar to what a commercial airplane flies above the Earth. Okay. So we'll never get a gravity map like this for any other planet. Okay. And when we did, so this area right in here, at the end of the mission, you can see we're down. So we got within 2 kilometers of basin rings on the moon. So we got some pretty amazing data there. Okay, so this just shows what the data looks like when it's coming in. So this is the topography of the moon, and these are just gravity perturbations with respect to an old gravity field model. So on the near side of the moon, we knew the gravity pretty well. The residuals weren't too bad, but when the far side of the moon, we had huge residuals with respect to the gravity model. And let's see. Okay, so whoops, let me go back here? Okay, these are just raw data residuals, and we needed, in order to achieve our science objectives, we needed to range to a few tenths of a micron per second, but we actually beat the spec, the system beat the spec by about a factor of 4 to 6 on average. Okay, all right, so so now I'm going to explain to you why we didn't just put the two spacecraft in a high orbit and monitor for a long time. So this is a power spectrum. So this is the RMS of power of gravity, and this is spherical harmonic degree, which is the spatial resolution of the field. So these are very short wavelengths out here. These are very long wavelengths out here. And basically, most of the power in a potential field is at long wavelengths. So it comes down like this. And then what these lines down here are error spectra. And wherever the error spectrum intersects a power spectrum, that means that basically your spherical harmonic coefficient. So spherical harmonics are just the solution to Laplace's equation on a sphere, and this is how we plot gravity. It indicates that the coefficients are 100% in error, so that's the resolution of your field. So this is a previous field by Lunar Prospector. This is a Japanese spacecraft called Kaguya that also mapped lunar gravity, and this is the error spectrum of Grail. So we're currently 3 to 6 orders of magnitude lower errors in our gravity field. So we've improved by a million, by a factor of a million. So that's why if we did long-term monitoring, we may yet get to 10 million without even going. But you know, obviously, we didn't need to do long-term monitoring. When you improve something by 6 orders of magnitude, you've done what you should do. We decided, though, we had an outrageous opportunity to do the highest possible spatial resolution map that we could make. So here's the Lunar Prospector map. So the near side of the moon is on either end of the diagram, and here the big red bullseyes are gravity highs. These are units of milligals, where a gal is a centimeter per second squared, and that's a unit of gravity. And this is the far side, and you can see the stripiness here is due to the fact that you weren't measuring gravity on the far side directly. And then this was one of the first maps that we pulled out of Grail.
Can you do that one more time?
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
Do the numbers at the top mean the degree of the model?
This is the, yes, so that's degree in order 150. And this is 420. And we currently have, we just got a degree in order 900 model out of the queue. But it doesn't even pay to plot it here because the resolution of the screen just can't take advantage of it. So in this map, this is the one we published in Science in January. In this map, we resolve, the resolution of this map is 13 kilometer block sizes. So we basically resolve every crater on the moon, 30 kilometers and greater, most craters greater than 20 kilometers. This is to the people on our team the most amazing result of the mission. But let me explain to you what's going on here. This is just a correlation coefficient between gravity and topography, and this is the correlation on this axis and resolution here, where these are short wavelengths and long wavelengths. So when you're down in this area, there's all sorts of stuff going on, and those are the mass cons and the big basins and things. But then when you go out to shorter wavelengths, gravity and topography are correlated at 98%. So these are two data sets. We also have a topography experiment that's orbiting the moon right now, and two data sets completely separate that correlate at the 98% level. And so what that means, actually, is that if you look at a gravity map of the moon and you look at a topography map of the moon, they essentially look the same at short wavelengths. So, and so how could that be? Okay, well, the only way that it could be is if most of the gravity is due to the topography. Okay, then the maps would look the same. And so it means then that at short wavelengths, where you have these high correlations, that virtually all of the gravity is coming from topography, and virtually none of the gravity is coming from the inside of the moon. Okay, and but you know, I mean, at long wavelengths, you know, we still have the large impact basins and the mascons. So, but we're talking about shorter wavelengths than that, and what this actually is an indication of is that the moon has just been completely fractured and homogenized by the impact process. Okay, yeah.
I'm not familiar with the terminology you're using when you're describing wavelength in this way.
Right.
Is the right way to think about that, like a long wavelength is like a very large scale structure?
So the longest wavelength is the circumference of the planet, okay? Uh-huh. And the size of an impact basin is a long wavelength feature. And a crater or a crater rim is a very short wavelength structure. So it's basically spatial scale. So
okay.
So it's basically 2 pi over the wavelength. So, okay? Yeah. So on the far side of those spectral diagrams, that's all these little craters right in here, and the longer wavelengths is, you know, the basins and even the near side versus the far side, you know, all that stuff. Okay. All right. So we had known that impact should fracture a planet, okay? But it was a big surprise that the outer part of a planet should be so pulverized that the entire crust would be homogenized by impact redistribution. And this actually has huge implications for other planets, which I'll talk about in a minute. So I want to explore this a little bit more. So this is just another projection of this is a topography map. So this is the near side, this is the far side over there, and there's that big impact basin that I talked to you about. And then here's there's the gravity field. Okay, so you see the mascons here. You also get mascons on the far side as well, and other things going on. And then this is what happens if you subtract away the gravitational attraction of the surface topography. Then you lose all the short wavelength structure. So then you're just seeing the big, long spatial scales. And then then you don't even see the basin, so we filter out the long wavelengths on that. We filter it out, so we sharpen up the short wavelengths so that we can say something about what the short wavelength structures are on the moon. So then you do this and you can go in. So everything you're seeing here is due to the inside of the moon, not the outside of the moon. Okay. All right. So we're interested in studying the structure of the crust. And you're probably getting the message right now that in geophysics we do a whole lot of things in wave number domain, okay? And this is another one of those things. This is an admittance function, which is basically the cross power of gravity and topography over the auto power of topography. And so that's not an important thing to remember. What is an important thing to remember is that at long wavelengths here, so wavelengths of the lunar basins or the near side, far side, you see that this function is complicated, okay? And so this is because the crust thins under basins. The crustal thickness is different on the near side versus the far side. But when you get out to very, very short wavelengths, small spatial scales, this function only is a function of the density of the crust. Okay, so if you calculate this function in the short wavelength limit, you can calculate the density of the lunar crust. And this turns out to be very important for lunar scientists because they want to understand the composition of the moon. Okay, and so we did that, and we came up with a density of 2550 kilograms per meter cubed. And so I heard nothing. So I'm in a room full of engineers. What does that mean? Okay, when I give this talk in front of a group of scientists, they gasp. Okay, and that's because rocks aren't 2550. Okay, we thought the density of the moon's crust was about 2900 kilograms per meter cubed. So this is an indication it's not dense enough, given what its composition is. Okay, so one way to explain that is if it's fractured. Okay, so you can calculate porosity. So if you know the density of what the rock is, if it isn't fractured, and then you have the density that you measure, then you can calculate how fractured it is. So we do an effective porosity, and we calculate a value of like 12%. So, and you can also see that this porosity is greater around the largest impact basin. So here you're seeing the ejecta being thrown out of the impact basins. So, and in this basin, it's less, and this is because you're digging deeper into the crust, so there's less fracturing as you go deeper. So we can now use maps like this to go in specific areas and just see the effect of impacts and fracturing up the crust. Okay, so one of the highest priorities in lunar science is to land a mission on the far side of the moon inside this basin, which is called the South Pole-Aitken Basin, and bring a sample back. So you might have heard about that either in this class or in some other venue, because it gets talked about a lot. And the reason for wanting to bring a sample back from this basin is because this basin is so deep that you're actually sampling deep in the moon. Okay, so it's going to tell you something very important about what the composition of the moon is as a function of depth. Okay, these stars here correspond to outcrops of a mineral called olivine, which is an iron magnesium silicate. And these measurements were taken by the Japanese Kaguya spacecraft. And olivine is thought to be the composition of the Earth's mantle and the moon's mantle. Okay, if you go, and there's some on the dark side here, but you're actually seeing the lower crust if you go to the bottom of the South Pole-Aitken Basin. And we now can see from, we not only know the composition of the moon, but we, from the gravity and topography, we now know the latitude-longitude grid and the positioning on the moon so well that we could technically land anywhere. So if you know there is an outcrop of olivine there, this had to be brought up from the mantle, you could go bring a mantle sample back and land on the near side rather than the far side. And then you don't need a communications orbiter to stay in touch with. So actually, the people doing, proposing the far side mission, there's still a lot of value to going to the South Pole-Aitken Basin and bringing a sample back from the far side. But one of the reasons that mission hasn't been selected yet, because you're out of communication with the Earth, it's very complicated, it's very technologically challenging. If it were me and I wanted a deep sample of the moon, I want a deep sample of the moon, and so I'll take one from here and bring it home, and then happily cheer these people on who are going to do this mission once they can get their communications orbiter going.
Did all of you end up there? Did like the impact puncture the crust in it?
Yeah, what? Exactly. So two things happen when you have an impact. So it's a shock wave. So first of all, you excavate material, okay? But essentially, a shock wave propagates through the moon, okay? So material gets thrown out, but as the shock wave propagates, it interacts with heterogeneities inside the moon, which generate another wave that propagates in the other direction to unload, because it's in a highly stressed state. So you have to unload the shock wave, and this other wave, which is called a rarefaction wave, causes the crust mantle boundary to lift up. And so this is why the crust, which this is a crustal thickness map, this is why the crust is thinned under those basins. And it essentially brings material up from the mantle to the surface. So you see all these areas where you have stars, they're all near impact basins. So one of the things you could think about if you wanted to design a mission is, you know, bringing a sample back, a mantle sample, a deep sample of the moon back from the near side as opposed to the far side. So I mean, this just keeps with my own philosophy of, I just like to do the stupidest, cheapest thing that I can do that gets me the answer and fly lots of stuff in space, okay? So that's the way I go about things. But there are different, whatever you like, you know, you can do. Okay, so let's see. I wanted to spend the last several minutes talking about education and outreach. So on this, I teamed up with Sally Ride, and we decided. I decided that if I ever got a chance to do a mission, that I really wanted to do something outrageous in education, not the usual thing. I mean, NASA does a lot of good things in education, but not outrageous things. And I wanted to do something outrageous. So so did Sally. So it was great. So what we did is we bought some rocket cams. So these are cameras by a company called Ecliptic. And it's the ones they put on the outside of the rockets so that you can see the stages separate when they take off. So they're pretty—they're not very sophisticated, but they're pretty rugged, right? Because they have to deal with launch stresses, and so we put electronics and four camera heads on each spacecraft. And the thing that was groundbreaking about this, we said there is no scientific measurement that will be made with these cameras, okay? Because once you say that you're going to do any science with it, then they get held to really, really high standards of scrutiny by NASA, and we wouldn't have been able to afford to do the experiment. So I had to say, we want to do this, but it doesn't matter if they work or not, okay? So there is no requirement to get even one image from these cameras. So we got really good, when we wrote the proposal, we got really, really good reviews on the wanting to do this, because it was different than the usual thing. And what we essentially wanted to do was, Sally's company provides software to schools, and we targeted it at middle schools because we put some exercises together for middle school students, but we took everybody. We took church groups, you know, Boy Scouts, anybody, homeschool kids, YMCAs, you know, you name it. And anybody who wanted to participate could participate as long as there was an adult involved. Okay, now it turned out, and so the kids would learn to use the software, they would see where the spacecraft were going to be going over the moon at any given point, and then they would target what image they wanted to take, and you know, we would upload the commands, and the images would be taken. So it turns out the kids taught the teachers how to use the software. Okay, the teachers didn't know how to use the software, but all the kids did. And we had 200,000 students from every state that were involved in this project. And we got 192,000 student images of the moon with this program. So it was a great success. And what I'm going to show you now is, let's see, it takes a few minutes to load this up. But this is a video that we took with the camera when the spacecraft was 10 kilometers above the surface of the moon. So this was a few days before we crashed. And so it's about 1,500 frames in the second part and about 1,000 in the first part. We're at a bad sun angle to start off with. But this is essentially what it's like to fly above the moon in an airplane if the moon had air, okay? So. So this actually was the lead story on the NBC Evening News when we released the video, and this just goes to show that the important thing was not to have a good camera. The important thing, and this was Sally's vision, was that. It doesn't matter if it's a good picture or a bad picture. If you have a student involved, the important thing is that the image is theirs. Okay, so we would upload everything onto the web with just a code number, so the students could go home and show their parents their image of the moon. And we also made an app where they could carry it around and show their friends at school the images that they took of the moon. So, this isn't bad. So we've imaged the moon, and so by the standards today, where we can take 50 centimeter resolution images of the moon, the images that we have of the moon from this the MoonCam investigation are only slightly worse than the global coverage of Mars that we had from the Viking orbiter. Okay, so. The Viking orbiter covered Mars at 200 meter resolution. We have 300 meter resolution from MoonCam. And one of the things that was just amazingly touching to me is when I went to the Lunar Planetary Science Conference in March, there were presentations there of scientific studies using MoonCam data. So it did turn out to have more utility than what we actually thought. All right, all good things need to come to an end. And when you're down at 23 kilometers average altitude and doing three maneuvers a week, you're going to run out of fuel eventually. So we were going to hit an eclipse, and so we knew when the end was going to be. But we actually adjusted our altitude so that we would map the moon and use all of our fuel right before the eclipse. Okay, and so I said, if I want to use every bit of the fuel in both of those spacecraft for science, and if we have any fuel left at the end, then we didn't fly low enough. Okay, so the only requirement that I got from NASA is that we could not crash. At or near a site of historical significance, and so which I said, believe me, I am not the person who wants to mess up with an Apollo site. So we did a lot of due diligence and found an unnamed mountain on the near side of the moon at high latitude because we wanted to name it after Sally. Okay, which we've now done. So this is just a simulation, pretty bad. Well, if you run it on a faster computer here, it would look well. But this just shows you what happened here at the end. So it comes in, and they both crash here. And this is the, here are the two crash sites. The Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter changed its orbit so that it would fly over the mountain right afterwards. And so this is a temperature map, and you can see that this gets up to like 200 K. So this is an area that sees the sun every lunar month. But that said, it was the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter made the first detection of atomic hydrogen on the moon. So it's actually an important discovery because we were not expecting to see atomic hydrogen in the moon, and it was not predicted because hydrogen's very volatile, but it says something about the moon actually has a monthly volatile cycle, so hydrogen comes and goes. And we knew that this was the case in the polar regions that see very little sunlight, but we didn't think it would be the case. Yes?
Would that hydrogen be impregnation from the solar wind, or?
That we don't know whether it's the solar wind or whether it's deeper. And that's something that's being studied now. So we just did a press release on this last month with the observation. And so there's a lot of discussion now about what the source of the hydrogen is, whether it's solar wind related or whether it's deep interior related. We do know from analysis of lunar samples that lunar samples come from source regions that have as much as 800 or 900 parts per million water, which is something we didn't know was the case back in the Apollo days. So it's not out of the question that it came from the deep interior, but we don't know what this particular hydrogen that was put there, but we were surprised. Now this was, at the time of this impact, this was in the dark, so it's possible that it was there in the dark and then it volatilizes. It would volatilize if it's near the surface when the sun hit it. And then these are two, so we found the crash sites on them, and these are A, which is ebb, and B, which is flow, and you can see each one made about a 4 or 5 meter crater, and you see the dark halo there on both of them. So we took once we decided where we were gonna crash, the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter made sure they had before pictures taken so that we would be able to do after pictures and look for the crash sites, which we did. So that was fun. So it was. I'll say it's. It was very sad to see them go, but it's a lot of fun to crash spacecraft into the moon. Okay, and so I'm done, and this is just to let you know that I deserve almost no credit for what was done here. These are the people who deserve all the credit. Okay.
Really, really true. Let's start off with questions specifically having to do with GRAIL and the material that Maria has described to us today, and then leave some time to pick her brains about some of the other issues that have come up in the lunar science discussions and in your projects.
Just a question about the crash. Were you able to get any pictures from those cameras, like on the final?
No, it was in the dark. Yeah, so we, and I got so many questions and emails about how stupid could you be crashing in the dark and not, taking movies on the way in, and the reason actually was that we wanted a near side site and we wanted to name it after Sally, and that was the reason for it. So I'm willing to take and have taken any amount of heat for that. So
would it have been possible if it had been during the daytime?
We had a real time we had full DSN support. So the other thing we did on the way in that you guys would probably care about is that we did a burn to depletion maneuver on the way in so that we could see actually how much fuel we did have left, Because you use these, so the engineers use these techniques where they turn on the heaters and they, you know, do all this stuff and they estimate how much fuel and given how the instruments performed compared to what the design specs were, I said, you guys have too much margin, you know, this is, so I don't want fuel left, and they, but we had almost no fuel left when we did the burn to depletion maneuver, so we were then calibrated all those models, but they really did stay true to using as much fuel as they could, yeah.
Percentage-wise, how far off were the fuel models versus the actual fuel that was left?
It was like kilograms, yeah. No, it was, yeah. So
did you do a complete mapping at 55 kilometer altitude and then another complete mapping at the lower altitude?
So what we did is so you actually map the moon in 2 weeks. Okay, so it takes the moon a month to rotate, but you get the near side, far side on every rotation. It's a 2 hour orbit, so you get 12 orbits a day. So after 2 weeks, you map the moon once, and then you keep mapping it. Okay, so that's how we were able to get this little precession term in it, the real-time precession term. So we actually had lots of mappings, but the obviously after 2 weeks, it's 2 degrees, which is 60 kilometers at the equator. So you have very high resolution along track, but pretty coarse resolution across track. So you fill that in over the course of many mapping cycles. So 3 months at an average of 55, and then 3 months at an average of 23. But as you could see, it was really variable. Yeah.
Based on your lunar crust model, which of the Apollo landing sites had the best potential outcome for the geology to find the crust samples?
There was only one that did the highlands, okay. You see, the thing is, they kind of all landed almost all landed. It was only Hadley Rill, really, where you were actually getting highlands samples. So none of those actually did get close to mantle samples. So you really want to go to Mare Crisium here. So here's Serenitatis, here's Imbrium. You really want to go here. Any other questions?
So if we could, okay. any other questions specifically okay. on today's talk, and then we'll get to some more general ones. Yes.
I have a question. You were talking about how the mission met all of its objectives and really exceeded all of its objectives, uh-huh. And then talked about how your philosophy was just pick a goal and really focus on it and don't make it overly complicated.
Yeah.
And how your spacecraft never went to safe mode and kind of. How do you think that applies in general to engineering missions where you're like, all right, let's take this philosophy where we have this goal, we're going to focus on it, we're going to do it the simplest way we can. Like, do you think that should and could apply more broadly to all missions?
So the thing that was, the thing that was really critical was we took the, you write the proposal in two parts. So you write a proposal, then that goes through a review with about 24 or 30 proposals, and then they down select to 3, and then you write another proposal. And so at the end of the second proposal, that was what was selected. And I said, this is what we are doing, okay? And so those numbers that I show you that you met last night, we set those. When we wrote that proposal, we said, this is the mission that we're going to fly. These are the specifications, and that's what we're doing. So as soon as you get selected, everyone you know and lots of people that you don't know all contact you and say, oh, I have this great blank that you could just put onto your spacecraft. Or have you thought about, as long as you're measuring blank, couldn't you measure blank? And I... did not accept one single thing. Okay, the only way that I would let anything change from what was in the accepted proposal was that if it looked like what we had proposed had not been either sufficiently thought through or sufficiently known, that it introduced unacceptable risk of to the success of the mission. So just setting the requirements up. So the engineers, when they started, they knew exactly what they were designing to. So everything was all, it was all catted out, you know, all the measurement objectives, everything was just done. And then nothing changed, okay? So they were always designing to the same thing. And like the most common thing that happens in these missions is, oh, we didn't do the thermal model right, you know, let's just have a look at that. So so that last objective that we, you know, I sent the memo and that we just met last night. So every review that I had, my review board was saying, you're not going to meet this, you know, because all the simulations were showing that we were not quite there, you know, or far away from there. And I knew all the engineers were all padding everything, you know, but you can't say that. And I just, and so basically my review boards wanted me to redesign the spacecraft to prove to them, to assure them that I would be able to meet those numbers. And I refused, and I said, I accept the risk of not meeting my objectives, but I will not redesign my spacecraft to, and look how much margin I wound up with. So now it could have been that that everything was as we saw, you know, as it appeared, and that I wasn't going to have enough margin, I wasn't going to meet that. But I figured I would be forgiven if I didn't blow my budget, you know. it could be done. So, but I think, you know, really the key thing is really, you know, when you start the thinking about the risk, you know, just really, really thinking about what are the things that could cause this to go off the rails, and really putting a lot of attention there at the beginning, because you know, over the course of the mission, things emerge all the time that you hadn't thought about, and you have to deal with those. But if you know, if there were things that you should have thought about, you know, then it just puts you in that much of a worse position. So the contingency that you build in to your budgets is really for things that are unknown, not for things that you should know and you just didn't, you thought you would deal with later. You know, I mean, just hitting that stuff early, you know, I think is pretty crucial.
Yeah, so, good question.
So yeah. You mentioned that the spacecraft was single string. That means no redundant components in any aspect?
There were a handful. And actually, we blew a circuit on one of the redundant ones, one of the few that we had a redundant ones. And it was a, you know that solar storm, May of 2012? Yeah, that triggered something bad. But there was less than a half dozen things were redundant, so. Less than a half dozen circuits.
So a related question, did you do any software updates to the spacecraft while it was on orbit?
We did a handful of patches. I think there were like two software, we did a handful of software uploads. Yeah, but they were tiny, but they were like a line or two. I mean, it wasn't even a subroutine.
Back to your engineering review boards, have you thought back sort of on a cultural level or an experience level why they were giving you that feedback? Is it the age of the reviewers or the cultural conservatism of NASA?
I really appreciate my review boards because they gave me they gave me a lot of really useful things to think about. But there were too many reviews, and there were too many reviewers, okay, and it's the cultural conservatism, really. So, you know, a little mission, the review board was like the size of this room with people here. And all these people were getting paid a consulting fee to come. And so they all had to say stuff, right? Right? And so, you know, what we found the most useful is, you know, pick a topic. I mean, you know, any topic that you want, like, I don't know, the ranging tone. Is it, you know, is it going to be able to really calibrate the clock? So, so we would call our, you know, we would call members of our review board in, and we'd invite them in, and we'd sit around the table, and we'd open up the laptops, and go in and really ask them to hammer away and really look. And those were the things that were really the most valuable. You know, very little came out of the big formal reviews, but we did a lot of these what we call tabletop reviews that were just really incredibly, incredibly helpful. So,
Maria, let me. Sherry, go ahead.
Yeah.
This is science related. If you could get a sample return of any type of sample, what would be your most valuable number one priority?
For bringing a sample back.
For a sample return.
I would want to get the oldest possible rock that I could get. Okay, we know where the oldest areas are on the lunar surface now, so we would know where to go. But you don't actually know what the oldest rock is until you bring it back and measure it. You know, if you have various rocks sitting on the surface, you don't, so you can go to a relatively old area. So, an old rock and the oldest possible rock, and if that rock happened to have iron in it, that would be extremely helpful because one of the things I'm interested in the thermal evolution of the moon is when the moon had a magnetic field, the period of time when the moon had a magnetic field, because that basically tells us about the dynamics of interior, and rocks with iron hold onto the magnetic field, whereas the highland rocks don't. So they're not magnetized. Yeah.
So the question about sample return inevitably mm-hmm. brings me to ask mm-hmm. you about human return to the mm-hmm. the moon and the ongoing debate that you're well aware of.
Mm-hmm.
Leaving aside the non-science issues, mm-hmm. you know, like preparation for Mars and so mm-hmm. on, what is your view of the potential benefit and the potential cost of human return, and what kind of returns should be considered?
Actually that's a good question. So I'm a huge proponent of human spaceflight. Even though my career is robotic mm-hmm. spaceflight, and in fact, I got invited to testify before Congress on it was a hearing on human spaceflight, mm-hmm. and I think they invited me because they wanted somebody to come in and give the alternative point of view of, oh, we don't need to send humans to the moon. And I went in very strongly in support of humans returning to the moon. If the only issue was science, okay, it would never be cost effective to send a human to the moon, okay? Because you could always do very interesting science robotically, okay? You could pick a question that you would need a human to do, but if given that there's so much about the moon that we don't know, you could come up with a whole set of rich ideas that would keep you guys designing amazing robots looking at for many, many years to come. But that said, a human can do things that a robot just can't do, the idea of seeing green glass out of the corner of your eye, you know, maybe a robot would have found that, but you know, maybe not. One thing technologically that a human could do that would be very interesting to do on the moon is a human can dig more easily than a remote coring device could. So I mean, autonomous coring is something that that kind of goes in and out of favor, and there is some design work being done on it. But you know, this whole question actually about where the hydrogen is coming from, is it coming from the solar wind, or is it seeping out of the deep interior? Imagine what you could learn if you could really do a deep core into the moon, and be able to sample carefully, and say, that's something that a robot couldn't do, but a human could do. And actually, we've had this crazy idea that you could actually use a deep core in the moon to go back and help you calibrate the Earth's climate history, because there are questions about whether early climatic variations are due to variations in the sun. Okay, well, the Earth and the Moon are both seeing the same sun. Okay, and you could go down to a level in the Moon where when you're below the diurnal skin depth, where you're not seeing the daily variation, but you could go down to some level where you're saying, okay, well, I want to see what the effect was here, at this many thousands of years back on Earth. So that would take a deep drill core, and it would, I don't know that it would solve the climate question, but it would be what would be found would be definitive. Whether it would be worth the cost, I don't know. But if human exploration was deemed important, this would be an extremely valuable thing for humans to do.
And would you think in terms of a fixed habitat laboratory with the ability to make excursions, or would you think of multiple missions with just go there, pick up some rocks, and come back?
It would be nice to stay, I think. I should tell you, we're looking for lava tubes with this data. There are some skylights, that they've detected with the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter. Our data can resolve the skylight. It has not yet, but it has the resolution to resolve. It's going to take a while, but we'd love to have a naturally built habitat there that you could just embellish somewhat.
I've just come back with a day with Red Whitaker, so he's pounding on that.
Yeah. Could you speak a little bit about how this project with GRAIL got started? Was NASA soliciting for proposals, and how specific were those proposals?
Sure. This was a NASA Discovery mission. So NASA puts out calls, and that's a solicit ideas for planetary science ideas from the scientific community. So it could be anything. As I said, back from the origin of mass cons, those of us who study gravity, I have this mental list of things I'd like to do, and some of them you could just do, and some of them actually I may never do just because circumstances warrant that they can't be done. But the gravity field of the moon, it's one of these things I've had in the back of my mind, and for years and years people would say, well, why don't you try this, and I'm just no, because aside from it has to be the right time scientifically, it has to be the right time technologically, it has to be the right time politically. And so there was the combination of the Chinese are going to the moon, GRACE, the GRACE mission giving you the technology that you needed, and the U.S. sent, and other countries doing a bunch of things at the moon where you could say, okay, well, all this stuff has been collected, but we still don't know what's going on because blank. That made it such that we decided to propose. We'd been thinking about this sort of thing on and off for 20 years, and there's all these reports that we wrote that were just sitting on the shelf. But when it came time to write the proposal, we knew what we were doing. But my thing was, I really just want to write this proposal once. Because normally, to win a mission, you got to write it three or four times, and it's another decade. And I just said, we've been doing this for 20 years, just on the cheap, and I really just want to do this once. And so we really figured out what would cause us to not get selected, and just hit those issues pretty hard. So, yeah.
So given those factors, available technology, scientific objectives, competition, and politics, what's next?
What's next? Yeah, that's a really, well, I guess we're going to go grab a little tiny asteroid, right?
What's next for you?
What's next for me? Well, as soon as I ascertain that NASA will give me another $500 million, I have several things in mind. So, but they won't do that now. So I won't write another proposal in the short term, just because they're not going to give another proposal to the same PI a couple of years after they just finished. So as soon as I perceive politically that it's possible, I'll be ready to rip. So yeah.
It's two not very related questions. One is that I thought I heard you mention that there is a portion of the upper core of the moon that is still liquid?
That's correct, yeah.
I did not realize. That's really interesting.
Yeah.
How warm do we think it is down there?
It's above the melting temperature of iron. slightly. But the, those numbers that we've kept, that we only got out in the last couple of weeks, will allow us to get not the absolute viscosity, but the contrast in viscosity between the inner core and outer core and mantle. So so we're going to, now that we have those numbers, we will go back and use those and jointly invert with the Apollo seismic results again to try to get a better model, because that there's a lot of scattering. They didn't resolve the deep structure very well. But if you put some constraints on the model from this, you can relieve issues in the Apollo data set. So it may be possible to do better with that. So
the second question was, what was the lowest TRL technology you used in the program? Like when you first were accepted, okay, we're going to give you money to build this thing. Was everything pretty established, or did you have any really low?
Nothing was below 7.
Okay.
So.
Everybody knows what TRL is?
Yes.
Maria, this is a real treat. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you, guys.